anyone competes as an athlete, he does not win the prize unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer ought to be the first to receive his share of the crops. Consider what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Left to our own devices, we can understand little bits, but when we ask God's Holy Spirit to enter into us here and here, we gain more insight that we would never gain on our own. If you're like me, there are times when you read through Scripture over and over and over again, and then all of a sudden something goes, ding, I don't remember ever reading that, when it's been there every time you've read it. And that is the Holy Spirit working in our hearts to reveal something new each and every time we open up God's Word that is alive and active in our life. So the first thing he calls us, and he's talking to Timothy, obviously, but in verse 1 he calls him a child, in this case, his son. So the first thing we need to remember always as a believer is that we are a child of God. We don't deserve anything that we've received. We deserve help. And each and every one of us have been grabbed onto by the power of God and brought out of the depths of hell because he loves us. But we have been brought out. When we accept Christ and we truly believe him and in who he is and his sacrifice for us, and remember, there's a huge difference between, yeah, I believe in who Jesus is, and I believe in Jesus Christ as my Savior and I love him. There's a big difference in those two. One is just kind of, oh yeah, I think Jesus, yeah. Hey, I believe in God, I believe in Jesus too. But the other one is life-changing belief. Life-changing belief. We should be different than we were a year ago because our faith should be growing. And if our faith is not growing, we will struggle. Why? Because the enemy's tactics are increasing and intensifying day by day. And if we are not deeper in love with Christ, if we are not more able to handle accurately the word truth up here and here, we are in trouble. We're at risk. We're at risk of falling away. We're at risk of using excuses in our life to pull us away from a relationship with other believers, being involved in church, but also involved in his word and prayer time. Bless you. You bet, DJ. I get distracted too easily, man. I'm sorry. But as a child, here's the other thing. We can't do an awful lot without our parents. We try, don't we? From the moment we learn the word no, we try hard to do without our parents. And we push them aside. We start to think that they're really kind of stupid. And then later on in life, we realize that, wow, you guys were pretty smart. But as a child, we recognize, in this case, as a child of God, it should remind us of how humble we need to be, approaching not just the throne of our friend, but the throne of the God of the universe, the Lord and creator of everything, and our King. That's a humility piece that should be the beginning of every morning, should be throughout the day and end the day, as we recognize with humbleness that, God, thank you so much for loving me and saving me from where I was at before. So the first thing we see is that we're a child. Second thing we see in verse 2 is this. It says, and the things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, these entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. So in my full-time job, I have the privilege and the honor of teaching young people who want to become teachers. And I'm blessed that every now and then there's some of those folks in this room. And I love to see some of those students who are going to become teachers still engaged and wanting a relationship with Christ. It does my heart great good. But I know from years, a couple of decades or more now, of teaching these folks that when they become a teacher, the only way they are successful and the only way they are content is they pour their life into, they empty themselves into those students so that those students might grow. I don't know if you've seen posters. There's a poster of a candle, and beside it is a teacher is like a candle. It burns itself out, in order to illuminate the world to others. We pour ourselves into, as Christians, we're called to teach, to pour ourselves into our families, but also into others. The sacrifice of self has been a theme also that Paul is talking about. The other thing I read him here is this. It says to entrust to faithful men and women. That we entrust this. That tells me that he is also telling us that we are stewards of what God has given us and of his word. So that we are able to understand the charge that we've been given, the responsibility, and the realization of the influence that you have as a Christian. always watched by the world. The moment you tell somebody that you're a believer, you might get chuckled at, you might be kind of like, really? Or you might find somebody who's interested. From that moment forward, they're watching. They're watching who you are. Are you taking good care of the influence that you have as a believer? So that when others look at you, they may see the Word of God spoken, but they're going to see the Word of God and the love of God in our actions. I enjoy so much when I hear things like this. You have such a loving church. Dolly, you shared that with me today. You have such a loving church, and we do. This is a fun little body. A body that loves others well. I can't remember who it was that I hugged last week. But the person with them, it was their mom or dad or something like that, they said, oh yeah, Bill's a hugger. And I look around and I see lots of hugging going on. I see you greet people. The moment you walk in those back doors, Judy and Marceline won't let you get very far without a hug. Okay? I love seeing that. Now it blows some people away, because I don't know if you've ever gone to hug somebody and they kind of go, they're blown away a little bit. They might reach out real quick with their hand and say, stay back there, it's okay. We'll hug maybe later when I know you. Okay? And that's, I understand that. That's okay. Handshakes are great, man. But this is a loving church. That tells me that we are handling well the word of God. Not just here, but here. There's a balance with that. But we're also understanding the influence that we have upon the world. That we need, the world that's darkened needs the illumination that comes from the truth of God and the love that pulls us out of the depths of junk. Love can do that. So that we've seen that we're a child, that we're a teacher and a steward. The next one in verses 3 and 4. Suffer hardship with me. The backbone of what Paul has taught in almost every letter that he wrote, if not all of them, is that life as a Christian is suffering. That we are expected to suffer. Okay? So when it comes upon us, we shouldn't be surprised. And when it's intensifying as the world continues to move forward, we shouldn't be surprised. Okay? So suffer with me hardship. As a good soldier of Christ Jesus, no soldier in active service entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life so that he may please the one who enlisted him as a soldier. I want you to picture a soldier over in Afghanistan or Iraq. Some lady, some woman, some man, woman, who's covered in dust, but also covered in equipment and gear, hot, bullets. That is not a life of ease. That is not a life of comfort. Not a life of convenience. So here we're told that we are to suffer like a soldier for Christ. Many times I've said that every Christian's middle name is inconvenient. When we believe, we will be inconvenienced from that moment forward. Just especially if we live out the message of the gospel of Christ, and that is sacrificing myself for the good of others. For the good of another person, that myself should be not thought of, but the other person needs to be thought of more highly. We are taught by Paul here that we are to live the life of a soldier, which tells us that we're in a battle. We may not have bullets flying around us that we can hear, see, or feel at times, but I know that the enemy is always throwing his own arrows our way, that we need to be on guard always. The other thing I've noticed too is with soldiers is they are driven by their heart. Absolutely by the training of their mind and their body. But they're there because they believe in something. They believe in a nation. They believe in their families. They're there to sacrifice. Because everything in their head says, you know what, I might die. But their heart says, that's okay, we're going to serve. And that's what drives a good soldier. And you know where their comfort comes from? To me, what I gather as I read different things, and that is that comfort for a soldier comes from standing and sharing the fight with others, with another brother or a sister in battle. That's when you gain comfort. When you lock arms with somebody, you are then encouraged and comforted to know that you're not alone in the fight. Our fellowship is critically important, that we fellowship together and that we come to let each other know that we're not alone in this fight. Then the fifth one that it says, and I'm going to show a video clip here in a little bit, okay? The fifth, or in verse 5, he gives us another. He's got a soldier, teacher, steward, and a child. Verse 5. And also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not win the prize unless he competes according to the rules. How many of you love to hear the word rules? Rules are one of those things, it's like the word discipline. Discipline's a hard word to hear. Rules are a hard word to hear unless we understand that the one who wrote the rules loves us deeply. Every parent, when you're disciplining a child and you say something like, no, I don't want you to do that, we're not doing it because we take great pleasure in just bothering them, but we're doing it because we love them. Rules have direct application to what God knows will bring us joy, will bring us strength, will bring us courage, will bring us compassion, will bring us the opportunity to be able to reflect who God is to a world that needs to see it. I don't know if any of you have seen the movie called 42. It's the story of Jackie Robinson. Jackie Robinson, when he came into as the only African-American player to break the color barrier from the Negro Leagues into Major League Baseball, he came in at a time in which, and I hate this word, I'm only going to say it once, and then every time I say and you understand what it is, but the word Negro was thrown around always. And in this case, and in many cases, it was thrown around by people who called themselves what? Christians. Absolutely. The guy, what I was going to say is, in one of the scenes in here, just prior to this scene here, is that the manager on the opposing team, who was from the Phillies, I believe, used the word, the N-word, over and over and over and over again, standing right outside of his dugout, right out in front of everybody. Not only was he using it, but everybody who stands was throwing this word at, and the word boy, at Jackie Robinson. You know, it's hard enough to focus when you come to the plate, you have a round bat in your hand, and somebody's throwing a round ball, and the object is to hit it square. Okay? It's hard enough to figure that out, let alone having these kinds of things just bombarding you. And they're calling him all kinds of names. All kinds of names. Talking to the dugout about who he is, and that he's probably sleeping with all of these players' wives, all that kind of stuff, and he's just badgering the heck out of this Jackie Robinson. He's distracted and he's angry. When Hank Aaron was on par to break Babe Ruth's home run record, and he was within 10 or so, every game that he went to, he received letters. And in those letters were statements like, I'm going to kill you tonight. I'm going to be in the stands with a rifle. You're not going to have a chance to break this record. Can you imagine going to the plate knowing that somewhere in the stands might be somebody with a weapon drawn at you? How hard that must have been. Every place that they went, every place that Jackie Robinson went to, even sometimes his own teammates who were there and didn't understand what was going on, he had to endure that. So Jackie Robinson, in the scene right before this, he pops up, flies out, and he's running back, and this coach says, hey boy, and I'm going to use this word only because it's a teachable word. I hate the word. Hey boy, nigger, go look in the mirror. This is a white man's game. You don't belong, all right? Get that through your thick monkey skull. I got to believe that guy probably went to church every Sunday. He did not handle accurately the word of God's truth. He might have known some scripture up here, but it was a gulf between here and his heart. No clue what it meant to love others well. No clue what it meant to, like Christ, break the barriers that separated cultures, which is what Christ did every time he stepped forward and interacted with people. Okay? So there's a little bit of a moment when Jackie goes back down after he flies out. He goes down into the walkway behind the dugout, and he takes his bat, and he's just breaking it all over. And he's a broken man. He's an angry man. And this guy named Branch Rickey, who's the guy who signed him and drafted him and signed him and put him in the professional leagues, comes down, and Jackie's like, am I supposed to stand for this? I can't take this any longer. Imagine that, y'all. I remember at one point in time hearing somebody call another little girl, excuse me, a slut. I have three daughters, beautiful daughters, and don't even think about calling one of my girls or my wife a slut. But people do it all the time. And I'm like, golly sakes, man. How long can you take hearing that How long as a woman would you take hearing that? Not very long. So Jackie's wondering, how long do I handle this? Ranch Ricky comes out here and says, you have to ignore it. You have to ignore it. You have to play by the rules. And he said, I can't play by the rules. Not these rules. These are not God's rules. Jackie Robinson was a believer. He handled it with humility. Ranch Ricky came alongside of him to let him know, you're not alone in this. I'm with you. But you cannot respond. You cannot retaliate like this. I'm supposed to just take it? We will not impact the world. We will not change the world by being like them, is what Ranch Ricky told him. And what's amazing is that later on, Jackie Robinson comes up in the same game. He hits a single, he steals second, he steals third, and he steals home. And when he's declared home, safe at home, he looks at it. All he did was take a quick brand, a quick look at the opponent's dugout, especially that manager, and just went like this. What a great scene that was. Who was the bigger man? Jackie Robinson. Who do we talk about today? Do we talk about any of those fools that were saying these kinds of things from the stands as well as in the dugout? No. We talk about who Jackie Robinson is, like Paul. Like Paul, who lived out the gospel. Jackie Robinson did. Not those guys who were going to church and showing themselves at church every night and then going back and having their mouth filled with ugly junk. Okay? So in this scene, I'm going to show you. Jackie Robinson, if you'll be able to tell, he's running, or he's playing first base, and the guy hits him. And one of the worst things you can ever do to an opponent on first base, and I know it's done, is to step right here on him with steel cleats, metal cleats. And he gets stepped on right here. So we're going to show this real quick.
The Gordon Country scores hitless in four trips. Tyler Casey in his second inning relief. This game is just as tight as a new pair of shoes on a rainy day. Casey goes into his windup. Robinson is down. The ball is coming high from the leg, and he is down.
Damn it, Florida! You really should do it. You spike my guy!
Let's say, he dropped the beat right now. Q. Oh. Next guy up. Right in the head, right? Now, he says, oh.
No.
Give me up! Just give him up. Understand? Game's too important. Just give him up. I play ball.
You're tough on him, Dave.
Just give him up.
Okay. Get stepped on. And his teammates, and this would have been me, is this next guy you drill him in the head. That'd have been the coach and me. I just said, you make sure this next guy goes down flat, and maybe the guy after him. That'd have been the fleshly Bill Hayne. Jackie Robinson said, no. What's more important in the game? Just get him out. Just get him out. And he did. He got him out. Okay? And so Jackie Robinson played by the rules. The rules were not fair. The rules were against him, but the rules were the rules, and God had other rules for him, higher power rules, and that is living a life of honor and integrity. And representing who Christ is in his life. Phenomenal. The other thing I mentioned earlier about soldiers, when they feel encouraged, where their comfort comes from, is knowing they're not alone. Knowing that they are not fighting wherever they're at alone, that somebody's got their back, or you have their back. So this next scene is real quick. How many of you, you have to be my age or older to know this name, P.B. Reese. Big time player. Big time player, played with Jackie Robinson. And this is a scene in which Pee Wee Reese recognizes how alone Jackie must feel and what he does with it. And this is the kind of encouragement that we as Christians are called to, okay?
Can you say that a little more?
Yeah.
We're just here to play ball.
It's just a bunch of crackpots still fighting civil war.
Well, hell, we just won that summer, because the cornstalks wouldn't have that. We just ran out of ammunition.
Well, look, next time, Dean.
Ain't gonna be a big time, Dave. I don't have to walk here. Thank you, Dave.
What do you think, Nick?
I got family up there from Louisville.
I need them to know who I am. People need to know who you are. People who love Jesus Christ and are willing to lay down our lives for him and for others. You know, today, the people that have played against, their number's not worn by every major leaguer on April 15th, which is when Jackie Robinson broke into the leagues. It's Jackie Robinson's number that's worn by every major leaguer, not all those other idiots that profess something and did something different. You and I are called to compete by the rules, to be good soldiers, to suffer for Christ, to be beside and with one another as we walk forward our journey of life. Paul wanted Timothy to understand this. This young man named Timothy, who had fearful kinds of aspects in his personality, but to stand firm in the presence of who Christ is. How great was it for Pee Wee Reese to come alongside him? Now, I don't know if you heard the booing going on when he put his arm around him, but I guarantee it was worse than what we heard on that. But he said, I have family up there from Louisville, where it was serious issues to do anything like what he just did. He said, I need them to know, and everybody else to know who I am. By that, I'm with you, Jack. You're not alone. That's a huge aspect in our life with Christ, that we are remembered and known for who we believe in. Absolutely, we have a friend in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. But don't ever forget that he is our Lord, the King, and our Father, who loves us deeply. Finally, the last thing we're going to see here is verse 6. It says, the hard, we've seen soldier, we've seen teacher, we've seen athlete, now we're going to see one more. The hard-working farmer ought to be the first to receive his share of the crops. Notice that it doesn't say the easy life of the farmer. If you're a farmer, you know it's not an easy life. You're up really, really before anybody else is, and you're laboring while the rest of us are still sawing logs. And you go until the sun sets. I love this little quote here that I found. I remember the dirt, the sweat, and the aching arms and the aching back from working in the hayfield all day long. We would be so dirty that we had to wash off outside in the horse trough before we could go inside and get a shower. I didn't know what dirty was until I worked in the hayfield. And I didn't know what hard work was either. And I gained a great deal of respect for hard-working farmers. We are always to be at the plow. We're always to be sowing. We're always to be watering. We may never know what happens in somebody's life in which we come alongside. We might be the one who's watering, that God is using us to water. We might be the one who's tilling the soil. We might be the one who's kind of getting in there and pulling the weeds in somebody's life, including our own, but that person. We're not to worry about what's happening in their life. We're to be called, we're called by God to do those things all the time. As we raise children, we see ourselves as the person who's responsible for all those things. I had a wise guy who runs crew for up in Moscow and down here tell me this at one point when he was teaching us as faculty members, and that is that it's up to God to know what's behind the curtain. We're supposed to just do what he calls us to do. Because I remember sharing a story about being frustrated that my children weren't growing as fast as I thought they should, that they are not gaining a relationship with Christ in the way I thought they should. He said, Bill, yours is to water, till, and plow. You don't get to see behind that curtain. God will take care of it. And it was just kind of a lightning rod for me. One of those times, like Jennifer, a long time ago, when I remember praying for our kids and getting frustrated with things, and she said, Bill, at least they're alive. I remember my thought at that time was, you know, can't the bar be just a little bit higher than that? Just so higher than they're alive? And I'm telling you, now that they're all grown up and life has moved on, it was absolutely the best thing we could have been praying for. Keep them alive, God. Keep them alive. Because he never gives up on them. We're to continue to be farmers, athletes, soldiers, teachers, taking care of what's been entrusted to us, and always start with the fact that we are a child of God. Last thing we're going to read is verses 8 through 13. I'm going to have communion. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, descendant of David, according to my gospel, for which I suffer hardship, even to imprisonment as a criminal. But the word of God is not imprisoned. For this reason, I endure all things for the sake of those who are chosen, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus, and with it all, eternal glory. it is a trustworthy statement. For if we die with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless. See, this is, if you have a verse that you want to kind of remember, this is a great verse to remember. 13. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. God can't help himself loving you. God cannot help himself loving you. Please remember that. We will all fall short. Understand, we will fall short. This week, somewhere along the line, you and I will stumble and fall short of the bullseye. We will miss the mark. But God cannot help himself by not loving you. He loves you all the time. And all he waits for is for you to pick up, grab onto his hand, shake off the dust, say, I'm sorry, and move on. Move on. As a good teacher, as a good son or daughter, as a good soldier, as a good farmer, and as somebody who remembers, as Christians, don't ever forget, God cannot help himself but love. We have a little dog whose name is Cooper. Cooper is, I think he's gorgeous. But other people think he's pretty holy. He's a chug dog. You know what a chug is? Mixture between a chihuahua and a pug. And he goes around, and every now and then, you know, he's got a lip that kind of sticks like this, and his teeth are hanging out, you know, tongue is out. I, Jennifer, either, can't help it. We love him. And it's not that you all look like Cooper, please understand. I know I do sometimes. But God can't help himself loving you. That's an incredible truth. A powerful, releasing truth about who God is. And Paul wants every one of us to understand that. To be diligent. To always be ready. To always represent the gospel of Christ. And to be able to handle the word accurately up here and in here. So that these two meld together. To be able to love well, live well, and sacrifice ourselves for the good of somebody else. So today, as we get ready for communion, I'm going to ask you to do something. I've got the table set up for you to come up in rows or with family groups, however you'd like to do it. This side doesn't have a gluten-free spot. This side over here does. And I've been really creative. The gluten-free is in the green. And G, for green and gluten-free. Right? And those of you, if you do have gluten-free, you can use that one, didn't it? But this is what I ask you to do. We've been shaking hands, we've been handling things. As you come up today, what I'd like you to do is use this as one, an opportunity to wash your hands, but more so, I've never done this before. But to symbolize washing away the world, leaving the world behind. Telling God as you take a little bit of this, God, I'm sorry for whatever's going on. I'm sorry for the separation, whatever it might be. God, I accept your forgiveness. I accept you, the reality that you made me clean. You can do it as a couple, as a family, you can do it individually. Okay? And don't rush it. Don't rush communion. Take some time. When you come up and you stand around the table and do it, two or three others, maybe you don't know the people, maybe you do, but take some time as a family or as friends and just pray for them. Just ask one person to pray very quickly about what's going on, about each other. You don't have to know each other well to do that. Okay? So, on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he knew that Bill Hain would fall short. He knew that Bill Hain would be one of those guys who would struggle in his walk with Christ. As he looked forward to that cross and what he was going to endure, he saw Bill Hain. And I'm so glad that he continued to go to that cross. He went to that cross knowing that I would need it, that I would need to be cleansed each and every day. That sanctifying grace that continues to cover us up and mold us and make us stronger each and every day. So when he took that bread and broke it, he gave it to his disciples and said, this is my body, which will be broken for you. Do this when you eat it in remembrance of me. That's why I don't want you to rush. Take your time. Then he took the cup. And he took the cup to his, presented to his disciples, and he said, this is the cup of a new and everlasting covenant. This represents his blood, shed for the forgiveness of our sins. It's a joyful thing, but it's also something I want us to just not rush through. Take your time to think about it. Pray together. And remember what it is that Jesus did for us. Bow your heads and let's pray. Father, I'm so glad that you're a God who loves us. And you cannot help yourself. Because there are times I know in my own life that I do not deserve your love. But you know who I am, and yet you still love me. You love us. For God so loved not just portions of the world, but all of the world. So much so that you gave your only begotten Son. Bless you. So that, God, you would be put on display by how we live our life out. So, God, this morning as we celebrate communion, as we think about it, as we contemplate, as we examine our hearts, and then we experience the joy that remembers that you went to the cross for each and every one of us. May we let go of stuff and move forward with a clean heart as a good teacher, a good soldier, a good athlete, and a good farmer that represents who you are each and every day of our life. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. When you're ready, take your time, come up, grab a little bit of this, and clean off the hands, let it go, and come on up.
Thank you. What's that favorite?